Allahu Akbar.
A'udhu billahi minash shaitan ar-rajim. Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. Ashhadu an la ilaha illallahu wahdahu la sharika lahu wa ashhadu anna Muhammadan abduhu wa rasuluhu. Assalamu alaikum. Okay, let me know that there's someone present at the beginning here. Assalamu alaikum. Alhamdulillah, jazakallah. I want to first thank the organizers of the convention and also of this particular panel for allowing me to share a few ideas about how you and I are some of the requisite qualities that we have to have to step outside of the box. Now, stepping outside of the box can be done in a number of ways, but what I will attempt to focus on is stepping out feasibility law, not stepping outside of the confines or the parameters of Islam, but digging deep within ourselves to meet the challenges, the very unique challenges that we are confronted with here in the American landscape. You know, we can talk about, and I can talk about, how things were decades ago for Muslims here in the United States, but those times are gone. And those times are gone forever. There's a new reality that we must confront. And this new reality requires a very important quality, and that is the quality of courage. You see, decades ago in the United States, it took nothing for us to walk around all over this country wearing kimaras and hijabs and kufis and thobes and all of these things, and it made very little difference to our non-Muslim neighbors. That is not the case today. Now, whatever we do, wherever we go, we find ourselves under a certain kind of scrutiny to just see, are we those perpetrators of violence and hate the way we're so characterized in the media? So the days of just walking around with perhaps a near invisibility are days that will never come back for this part of the Ummah in this part of the world. So courage, our not having fear, our meeting head on the challenges that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala places in front of us, this is a most important ingredient if we are to move forward as an Ummah in this part of the world. Brothers and sisters, I want to just share just a few stories with you, some from the pages of Islamic history. Going back to the time of the leader of the first Islamic movement, the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Going back to a time, starting at a time after 13 years of revelation that this, our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that our prophet found himself under a death sentence in his own hometown, a town where he had grown up with people recognizing him as being honest and truthful, someone of high moral standing, someone who was a fearless kind of person, not a warrior, but someone who had the courage of his conviction. But we find after 13 years of the revelation that the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam had a death sentence passed on him. It was so serious that you and I know that the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam instructed his cousin Ali ibn Abu Talib radiallahu anhu, instructed him to lay in my bed on this night because I'm leaving, I'm making hijrah, I'm going to Yathrib. And there is this death sentence over my head, so I want you to stay in my bed and just pretend. You have to do nothing but just stay in the bed while I just go about my business. you and I know that the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam selected his sahab, his companion. And the one that he selected was Abu Bakr as-Siddiq. That you and I know that the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam and Abu Bakr, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in particular, was hunted down, that he was tracked by the best desert trackers trying to find this man to not allow him to join his other Sahaba in Yathrib, soon to become Medina, as the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam and Abu Bakr, as those pursuing him got close. You and I know the story, you know it better than I, that the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam and Abu Bakr sought refuge in the cave of Thawr. That in this particular cave, it was not an elaborate system of cave, that it was a relatively small cave where the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam and Abu Bakr went into the cave, and it was going down. And they went into this cave only trusting in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as the trackers got close. Those who were to bring the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam back to Mecca, dead or alive. That as they got close, the Sirah literature tells us that Abu Bakr as-Siddiq, a man who was courageous in his own right, that Abu Bakr as-Siddiq began to feel a lot of anxiety, a lot of tension, that he began to wonder whether or not their hijra, their attempt to join the other Muslims in Medina, would end right there in that cave. And Abu Bakr, as we find that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us about his attitude, that the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam in a Sahih Hadith reminds us that Abu Bakr, at this moment, as a believer in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, with pure iman, that the natural human tendency when thinking that your life is in so much jeopardy that you may die at any moment, that Abu Bakr showed and exhibited this human tendency and said to the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam that only if these people look down, they will discover us. That all they have to do is just not even searching for us, just look at their own feet and they will see us down in the cave. And the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam reminded Abu Bakr as-Siddiq, oh Abu Bakr, and we find this in narrations in both of the Sahih of Muslim and Bukhari, that he said to Abu Bakr as-Siddiq, oh Abu Bakr, what do you think of the person? Or what do you think about two and their third partner, their third person in this experience is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam relieved the anxiety of Abu Bakr as-Siddiq by reminding him that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was their protector, that there was no reason for Abu Bakr as-Siddiq to let this tendency of fear and anxiety rise to a point where he would be diverted from his mission. Brothers and sisters, reminding myself and reminding you about a little more about this man, Abu Bakr as-Siddiq. He was a man of conviction, a man of purpose. You and I know that Abu Bakr as-Siddiq was the first adult male to accept the call of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam of La ilaha illallah Muhammad Rasulullah. We know that Abu Bakr as-Siddiq accepted this with no hesitation. We know that Abu Bakr as-Siddiq, in the early days of the movement, perhaps in the second or third year of the revelation of the Quran, that the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam was around the Kaaba, and Abu Bakr as-Siddiq, with the courage that Iman just intensified in his heart as the Prophet Muhammad was attacked. Abu Bakr was reported to have been the only one to have jumped to the assistance of the Prophet Muhammad wasallam. That the other Sahaba, not wanting to disclose their identities as Muslims, not wanting to put themselves in harm's way, held back, and Abu Bakr was the only Sahaba that jumped into the middle of this beating and called upon these Quraysh, "Are you beating a man? Are you trying to kill him?" Simply because he's saying that there's only one God. Ali ibn Abu Talib, radiallahu anhu, years later would say that this was the moment, that I was a young person at this time, but this was the moment that I knew that there was no one in this ummah that had the courage and was as brave as Abu Bakr as-Siddiq, radiallahu anhu. In one more instance, we find that in these early days of Islam, when the Muslims, their first university, their first jama'ah, place of jama'ah for prayer, was in the house of a 17-year-old young man by the name of Akram. That this was the place where at night, the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam and the Sahaba would slip to his house. They would go there knowing that if they're caught, they may be tortured, they may even be killed. On one of the, at this house, this Bayt al-Akram, we find that at one point there were 38 Muslims who were meeting in this young man's house. And Abu Bakr as-Siddiq, there were 38 Muslims in all of Mecca. And Abu Bakr as-Siddiq asked the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, "Can I go to the Kaaba and give khutbah? I know how dangerous it is, but can I go? You're the messenger of Allah. This is the truth. Can I go and give khutbah?" The Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam was reported to have tried to discourage Abu Bakr. Abu Bakr insisted. So the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Okay, Abu Bakr, go and declare the oneness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If this is what you insist on doing," he went to the Kaaba. And as was the practice at that time, that the various tribes had certain sections around the Kaaba where they would join their tribesmen. When Abu Bakr went to the Kaaba, other Sahaba came around and they went to their respective tribes and stood with them. Abu Bakr began to give khutbah right there at the Kaaba, and the Quraysh fell upon him, almost beating him to death. And you and I know that after this beating, he was beaten unconscious, and his tribesmen, the Banu Ta'in, came and got him, and they put him like in a shroud, and they carried Abu Bakr to his mother and father's house where he was unconscious. And when he regained consciousness, the first thing that he asked was, "How is Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam?" When his father heard this, he got upset. "Now you've almost been killed because of this man. Now you're asking about him." The first words out of your mouth, his father started cursing at him and stormed off. His mother was trying to console Abu Bakr. To speed the story up a little bit, we find that Abu Bakr asked his mother, "Tell me about Rasulullah. I know I was really harmed, but I want to know about the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam." She said, "How would I know? I know nothing about it." And so Abu Bakr asked his mother, "Go to the home of Jamil. She's the sister of Umar ibn al-Khattab. She was at that time secretly practicing Islam." So Abu Bakr's mother goes to her house, and inquired about what's the condition of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, she acted like she didn't know what she was talking about. She said, well, take me to Abu Bakr, maybe I can figure it out. They go to Abu Bakr. When Abu Bakr hears her voice, he asks her, as he had asked before, tell me the condition of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. She told Abu Bakr that Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam was okay. He said, that's not enough. I need to see him with my own eyes. So Jamil and his mother took him to Abu Bakr's house. And Abu Bakr, at this point, even said, I don't believe it yet. Take me to the Prophet, where the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam is. They took him to Bayt al-Aqra, found the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam in good health. Nothing was wrong with him. Abu Bakr asked the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, O Messenger of Allah, make dua for my mother. I've done everything that I possibly can do for my mother to be guided by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. At this moment, make dua for my mom. The Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam made dua for the mother of Abu Bakr as-Siddiq, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala immediately opened her heart to this deen. The purpose of this story is that by showing courage, by being steadfast, that an unexpected consequence came from what seemed and what was a very bad situation. Abu Bakr as-Siddiq, as much as he loved his mother and wanted her to be Muslim, had basically gotten to the point, well, I don't know what it's going to take. But out of that circumstance, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala put his mother in a position to have the Messenger of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala himself to pray for her guidance in the conditions and circumstances in which we live today. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows best, but every day, no matter how many executive orders are passed, no matter how many people are suffering, how many Muslims are being beaten down on the streets, no matter how many masjids are being burned, we are called upon by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the example of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, those righteous predecessors of ours, to stand fast, to show courage, to call others to this deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Brothers and sisters, one of the most outstanding and notable Muslims that has been produced on the shores of America is Al-Hajj Malik El-Shabazz, Malcolm X. And for those who know anything about Malcolm, we know that he was not a scholar of Islam. We know that Malcolm only practiced the sunnah of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam for 11 months before he was martyred. We know that Al-Hajj Malik El-Shabazz, that Malcolm X, at the time of his assassination, that he was on a path where he was trying to learn about this deen, but one quality and characteristic that characterizes Malcolm X for everybody, Muslim and non-Muslim, who know anything about him, is his capacity, his inclination, what was his practice to speak a word of truth to power. People admire him. We're talking about him all of these decades later after his martyrdom. Not because we know so much about the details of his life, but we know that here was a man who would speak out of his conviction that he wouldn't say or do things just because others were doing it. When asked by a reporter whether or not, before he was martyred, whether he feared for his life, he said, I fear no one I fear nothing. There's nothing that I fear. There's no one that I fear and ask in another situation. Tell me, Malcolm, with all of these circumstances against African American people today, what would you do? What do you suggest? And Malcolm, putting the onus, putting the weight and responsibility back to those who were asking him, said, find out what you'll do. Find out what you will do. If it's the right thing to do, and I'll do the exact same thing, but it's just that I'll do more of it. Brothers and sisters, now is the time for you and I to have courage to act out of our conviction. Now is not the time for us to retreat. Now is not the time for us to hide the fact that we are Muslim, that we have a deen that has been perfected by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as the greatest deen that human history has ever known. Assalamu alaikum.